Hello, good evening and welcome. I'm Karima Brown and you're watching Political Exchange, where we unpack Africa's political economy. Zimbabwe, South Africa's northern neighbor, is gearing up for elections amid a cash crisis that could impact the smooth running of the entire exercise. More so if one considers that many of the enabling mechanisms meant to level the playing field and ensure free, fair and transparent elections are simply not in place. So what does a cash-strapped Zimbabwe on the eve of its most important election hold out for its citizens and of course also for the rest of SADC? To help us unpack the issues, I'm joined by Webster Zambara. He's from the Southern Africa Institute for Justice and Reconciliation. In Johannesburg, I'm joined by Professor David Moore from the University of Johannesburg. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us here on Political Exchange. Professor Moore, let's start with you. Cash-strapped, many of the key processes meant to ensure a free and fair process not in place. Is this going to be another disaster? Is Zimbabwe going to hurtle into another election result which may well be queried?
Well, I think disaster might not be the right word, but hurtling is. And I think the conditions now operate in the benefit of the ruling party. Chaos is working for them. And that's the way things have been going for the past number of years. Back in March, there was a memo which came out of the SADC meeting, and it said that SADC would fund these elections. The UNDP was asked by Tendai Biti, the Minister of Finance, for the funding, but when it was apparent that the UNDP was going to impose the rules and regulations of a free and fair election, ZANU-PF said, no, don't bother. So ZANU-PF is hoping either to get SADC to pay, or another angle was to get, you know, money from the diamonds or whatever is feeding that machine. So it depends, I guess, if people who have diamond money are willing to invest in something like an election, which is never too certain. So we have I think the ZEC, the Zimbabwe Electoral Commission, has about $30 million. And they need maybe 130. So they got about a quarter of what they need. Now we are seeing right at this moment a special election where the police and the army are not going very smoothly.
Exactly.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. No, that's precisely the point. It is quite chaotic.
Mr. Zambara, let me bring you in here. Are we able to use the kind of technical glitches that we're experiencing with the armed forces voting early as a kind of microcosm into what could well be the situation on a much larger scale when the general populace go to the polls on the 31st?
Thank you, and good evening to viewers. I think it's quite critical to note that these glitches are happening when the Zimbabwe Electoral Commission is only manning about 269 polling stations. And we wonder what the situation will be when they have to deal with about 10,000 police stations with about 6 million registered voters. And I think so far it doesn't bode well in terms of their preparedness, and it doesn't bode well in terms of how the election itself will take place. Particularly if you find what happened even yesterday, incidences of violence where the police force were trying to vote in Central Harare yesterday had to be dealt with by their colleagues in the anti-riot squad. So we also have that angle of violence happening during an election process, which is quite unique in Zimbabwe because usually the election days are peaceful and organized. But this time, if ZEC doesn't get its act together in the next 2 weeks, we could be in for a very rough ride.
Now, of course, everybody makes the point that chaos favors ZANU-PF. Violence favors ZANU-PF because of its traditional hold on the armed forces, the security apparatus of the country. But in a very real way, Professor Moore, the MDC is as boxed in, isn't it? I mean, it cannot very well throw its hands up and say, we can't participate in this election. It would essentially, cancel its entire presence out of the political game, so to speak.
Yeah, and in 2005, a half a year before 2005, they said, no, we're not going to go in. And, of course, they did go in. And in the past, various splinter parties, Muzerera's party and so on, have not run, and then they just lose out. Now, if the MDC is able to, and the NGO, civil society monitoring, are able to ratchet up a number of really, really big problems, what would be the next step? That's the question you're asking. Would it be, would we move into another unity government already? Would SADC say, well, no, wait a minute. Do we postpone these elections until you get things on track? Or will SADC pump that money in to the ZEC and hope that things will work a little bit better? It's an extremely fraught situation. I think the MDC now is, they're pumping out a lot of their real change messages on the email and so on, and they seem to be monitoring all the problems that Webster was talking about quite well. So that record is being kept. And today, much more than even 5 years ago in 2008, the record, the information capacity is there for civil society to monitor this much more closely. So it would create a very interesting dynamic.
Webster, let me bring you in. We read, of course, that the European Union, traditionally ZANU-PF's kind of Western enemy, if you like, has already indicated that it will be led by the SADC infrastructure on whether this entire process is in fact free and fair and transparent. Is that a victory for ZANU-PF, who's traditionally argued that Western powers ought not to dictate? Or is it a measure of the respect with which SADC is being held by other bodies, particularly non-African bodies, which, you know, many of whom are keen to slot in with an African response to the problems? Because invariably, whatever fallout happens will be SADC's baby to deal with rather than the EU's.
This is a very interesting scenario we are observing. But certainly, this is victory for ZANU-PF, no doubt about it. Because it's when the EU is now saying it is passing on the baton to SADC to make the position, to make a decision that will guide the relations going forward. It is actually an admission that ZANU-PF has stood its ground and said, no, we are not going to have observers from the West. Because the EU and the United States and their compatriots, they tried by all means to influence the position of SADC and to influence the unity government to allow them to monitor. And on this one, they failed. And if you relate just recently, there have been some overtures in trying to have them observe. But more to it is actually a realization of where the center of power is in Zimbabwe, and Mugabe has just proved that, because some rhetoric in the few months ago were suggesting that the MDC may influence the acceptance of EU monitors and Western monitors, and this has failed. And beyond that, which is perhaps more critical, is perhaps Mugabe charting a new ball game here in terms of international relations, in which Europe relates to post-colonial Africa, because his question has always been, if we can, we fought for independence, and if we are not observing your own elections, what gives you the locus standi to want to observe our elections? And the scenario in Zimbabwe gives a very good background to it, in that
I want to play devil's advocate, Webster. Webster, let me come in here. I want to play devil's advocate. I don't necessarily agree with you saying that this is a victory for ZANU. How is it a victory for ZANU if the EU accepts that the SADC is a legitimate structure that can ensure transparent, free and fair elections, which there are universal standards for? There are no particular African standards around that. How is it a victory for ZANU-PF? Surely it's a victory for African diplomacy, rather.
You may look at it that way, but in terms of this scenario, ZANU-PF has always been saying that if you don't remove your sanctions without, you remove your sanctions outrightly without conditions, if you don't, then you don't monitor. And this has been 50-50. So to ZANU-PF is tit for tat. And regarding the influence that Zimbabwe has and the interest that elections in Zimbabwe would have, ZANU-PF would feel victorious that they have blocked the EU block from observing its elections. However, going back to the issue of the African continent and SADC in particular, here is a situation where SADC observer mission denounced the 2008 elections and also the AU parliamentary forum. These are the institutions that monitored in 2008 and they decided that this election is wrong. So they are again mandated to observe this election, and the ball is now on Mugabe's court, that you can actually have an election which is monitored by your peers, and if it is wrong, it's wrong, it's not credible. If it is upheld, then good for the country.
Okay, let me bring in Professor Moore in here. Do you agree with what Webster is saying?
No, I think it is a victory.
Now, of course, before the break, we spoke, quite in detail about some of the shortcomings of the processes and, of course, the implications that would have. I want to shift the discussion now and look at particularly the kind of bigger economic issues. We know that Zimbabwe's economy went into free fall. There was a period of stabilization, but there's a lot of hardship at the moment. Some initial indications that the chaotic land reform program did in fact yield results in some instances. Webster, from where you're sitting, what is the economic imperatives of this election? Are people going to be voting with their stomachs, so to speak?
I think if you listen to the rhetoric that is coming up during these campaigns, there is a strong emphasis on the economy, with the MDC pushing for reviving of the economy and creating employment, mm-hmm. while on the other hand, ZANU-PF has got their empowerment mantra and also building on the issue of the land. So this election is basically on trying to move from a period of economic stagnation and decline that the inclusive government improved so far. So they are trying to build on it, and they are also both promising that they are going to deliver in that front.
Now, of course, it's easier said than done. We know from the crisis in Egypt, for example, with the bottom falling out of the Egyptian economy, that's the surest way to get thousands of people out on the streets, those who don't have work, those who are hungry, those who want petrol. Are the economic challenges, Professor Moore, that pertinent and that big a factor in the way in which people will actually vote, given the political dimensions of the economy? ZANU-PF driving a very aggressive indigenization campaign, and of course in some instances yielding some results.
Yes, I think at the last moment though, people will be still voting along the lines of, do we still want this aging dictator? With the dollarization, the American dollarization of the economy, as the government of national unity began, things started to pick up. You didn't have that horrible inflation. But since then, I think things have been on a steady decline. The various public opinion surveys that were carried out by Freedom House and Afrobarometer, and another one by the IIRI, say that people feel the economy has been doing better, but it has been very stagnant. You mm-hmm. need dollars, you need foreign, you need relatives in South Africa or the UK to yeah. send you money, that sort of thing. So, and the question of indigenization, I think, since it's a rhetorical device at the present, not too much has happened because of that. Nobody is quite sure what it really means. And I think the MDC is trying to say, well, no, this is just about the elite getting fatter at the trough. It's not about empowering the people. And so they have different lines there. The question of land, there was a book that came out in 2010. Everybody was delighted. Land reform was a great success. This book proved, apparently, that all these Western myths were wrong. However, the responses to that book by respected academics such as Bill Kinsey, who's been working on land issues for ages and ages, and Rukuni, another agricultural economist, they're becoming more and more critical about this. So it's you can't just say that because you got a piece of land, you're going to vote for ZANU-PF mm-hmm. anymore. So I think at the end of the day, it's going to be a gut feeling. Will those militia around the corner scare you? Will the Chipangano, mm-hmm. those youth gangs in the cities, will they be pummeling people and telling them to vote the right way? So it'll be a question of fear, of how we can be open, how can we express our openness, versus versus that. But I don't think the economic question is going to be really, you know, hit, and mm-hmm. it's going to hit the fan.
Webster, let me bring you in here. Of course, we know a lot about what is wrong with what ZANU has done in terms of governance and running the economy. The track record of the MDC is fairly patchy as well. Morgan Tsvangirai embroiled in a lot of political mudslinging, some of it sticking to him with allegations of graft and corruption. Of course, Tendai Biti receiving accolades for his management of the public purse in Zimbabwe. If the MDC emerges as the clear winner, does the party have political and economic policy and wherewithal to actually take Zimbabwe on a new trajectory?
My observation is that in terms of economic policy, these two parties are not very different.
Right.
If you look at even the land policy, the land question, the MDC admits that it is irreversible. If you look at the indigenization policy in their document, the JUICE document, the MDC admits that it is important. They only vary on the methodology. Mm-hmm. But critical now is the issue that ZANU-PF is controlling the levers of the economy. The land issue, the mining area, including the diamond where they are getting their revenues. And although the indigenization program is still hasn't had any results, but they've articulated it so well to the effect that I think people believe in them, which is what we don't find with the depth of conviction from the MDC. Although I would say, in terms of what they say about the economy, they are more or less the same. Mm-hmm. The issue has been who runs the economy, and that is where they differ, with counter accusations of corruption and counter accusations of lack of capacity and all that comes with it.
Okay, let's shift gear a little bit. Of course, everything that happens in Zimbabwe doesn't happen in a vacuum. There's SADC, of course, Zimbabwe's crises impact on its neighbors to varying degrees. South Africa, in many ways, carrying the can. Both of you have been involved in work around South Africa-Zimbabwe relations, a new book out. Looking back, Professor Moore, South Africa's role as facilitator, as key interlocutor on the eve of the Zimbabwean population going to the election, how would you rate what President Zuma's administration have been able to do so far?
Well, in 2008, when they had the SADC meeting in the DRC, everybody was hoping there would be great changes, mm-hmm. that Zuma was going to take this old regime in hand, and that he would do so much better than Mbeki. I think what it shows is that there's a lot of continuity in the relationships, which have deeper structural resonance, from the economy to, you know, a long history of flow of populations and so on. So there hasn't been a lot of change. The Zuma administration has had the GPA, the Global Political Agreement, which led to the National Government mm-hmm. of Unity, has taken that and has perhaps pushed it a bit harder than the old regime would have. And with the result that people like Jonathan Moyle, from months ago, and even years ago, has been screaming at mm-hmm. Lindiwe Zulu, and now with the recent screaming from all over. I think the lesson that I think has been learned from this administration is be more transparent, be more democratic. Back in 2001, Thabo Mbeki wrote a long, long, long page, 26 pages, about what was wrong with ZANU-PF. And you will never read a more critical, this was in the ANC 300-page document that went around that year. You will never find a more critical document. You know, if you're a Marxist and you criticize the government for relying on the lumpen proletariat for your support, that's what it says in that document. That's the worst insult that you can give any government. And at the end of that document, Thabo Mbeki said, we must have free and fair elections. Mm-hmm. Well, 2002 elections were not free and fair, I think we can say. Ibo Mandaza said yesterday at a meeting in Zimbabwe that ZANU-PF only got 18% of the vote. Right. Now those numbers are suspect. Anyway, if South Africa at that moment in 2002 had walked in and said this election was not free and fair, it would have created a big catastrophe. Mm-hmm. But 10 years later, where would we be? We might have had an MDC government in power for this long, and people would know what the NBC was mm-hmm. like. Not extremely difficult. Extremely difficult to run a government. There's no messiah that's going mm-hmm. to come and save the people. But now we're at the same place we were 10 years ago.
Webster, there is often a tendency among South African diplomats to take the South African peace settlement and try and replicate it elsewhere, which is why we often speak about governments of national unity and so on. There's also been the suggestion from the South African side, of course, that South Africa cannot be Zimbabwe's liberators, that the Zimbabwean people need to take the helm and drive the change for themselves. We've got less than 2 minutes. Your assessment of the South African government's performance so far, given the fact that ultimately Zimbabweans will have to decide for themselves what kind of government, which government they want, and how they want to run their country.
I think the South African government has been put between a rock and a hard place. On one hand, they want to keep the sovereignty of the country intact. On the other, South Africa also feels the pinch. Can improve without having to expose who is wrong and who is not. And this has been a difficult, delicate balance to keep, because the situation on the ground has been that South Africa could have done more, but also it has already done enough. Look, they almost opened their borders for Zimbabweans to come and do business here. They even gave permits during this period where they try to regularize the influx of Zimbabweans here. I think those are some of the measures that they tried to share the burden with their northern neighbor, with the hope that the situation would improve.
Okay.
But beyond that, I think it's also within the SADC architecture, peace and security architecture, which is still developing and which is still very weak. So we end up relying on South Africa as a country instead of SADC as a regional grouping.
Well, I suppose it would be fitting to end this program with your words, Webster, a difficult, delicate balance to keep. We will, of course, keep our eye very firmly on developments in Zimbabwe as the people there go to the polls expected on the 31st of July. Gentlemen, thank you so much. That's where we will have to leave it for tonight. Tune in again tomorrow night for another edition of Political Exchange. I'm Karima Brown. Goodbye.